The tickets have been scalped here for even end zone seats. You cannot get a seat to this football game. You could not. It was just like a playoff game as far as Packer fans were concerned, and they booed the Bears on and off the field during the warm-ups. They'll be supporting their Packers here today. The Bears received Del Greco's short kickoff. It's taken it by Dennis Gentry at the 15-yard line. Gentry to the center of the field, and is dropped at the 27, maybe the 28-yard line of the Chicago Bears. A 13-yard return. And Ron Burgess, just activated this week, made the tackle. The Bears bring out Jim McMahon at quarterback, Walter Payton and Matt Sui, the running backs, Dennis McKinnon with a gimpy knee, and Willie Gulp are the wide receivers. Covert, Bortz, Hilgenberg, Tom Thayer for the injured Kurt Becker, Keith Van Horn, and Emery Moorhead across the front. And the ball spotted at the 29-yard line on the kickoff return. The leading passer in the NFL, Jim McMahon, leads out the Bears. Slot formation to the left. Long count by McMahon. McKinnon in motion. Play action. In the flat for Sui, who was wide open, and the pass incomplete. It'll be second down. Defensively, the Packers loaded for bear literally today. Robert Brown at left end. Charlie Martin on the nose. Ezra Johnson the right end. The linebackers, Anderson, Randy Scott, Brian Noble the rookie, and Mike Douglas. Center of controversy last week after the game. Lee and Lewis on the corners, and the keys here, two rookies at the safeties, Mossy Cade and Ken Stills for the injured Mark Murphy and Tom Flynn. And that will be a key in this game, we expect. Second and 10. McKinnon in motion again. Draw play, Payton. Payton, ball comes loose. Packers say they've recovered, and they have. Inside the 30 of Chicago. And already a little roughhousing between Covert and Charlie Martin. Ezra Johnson of the Packers came up with the ball.
The Bears came up with the draw play off the pass action right off the ball game, and Payton goes through, and you can see that he takes the jolt, the hut, and it's Ezra Johnson who makes the recovery for Green Bay Packers. Shades of a game a couple of weeks ago when the Bears fumbled quite a bit early in the game. The Packers were not able to take advantage of it, as Ezra Johnson, one of the men who is really after the Green Bay Packers, was in on that action.
After the Bears, indeed. And Brian Noble forced the fumble. The Packers lead the league in forcing fumbles. 28 times they've done it. Recovered 17. And they have good field position here in the opening minutes of the game. That is Eddie Lee Ivory driving hard for 5 yards. Over the 25-yard line of the Bears. Otis Wilson made the tackle, number 55. Jim Zorn, the quarterback, the former Seattle Seahawk with his first start. Clark and Ivory, the running backs. Lofton and Epps, two speedsters at wide receiver. Across the front, Carl Swanke. Rookie Rich Moran for the injured Euchre. Cannon, Hallstrom, Cook, and tight end Paul Kaufman. And now they bring out Ed West to join Kaufman here on second down and 6. Misdirection to Clark. Clark, a hard-running fullback, plows for about 2. It'll leave 3rd and 5. Stopped out the right side by Hampton and Dave Duerson. Defensively on the Bears' four-man front, the change, William Perry, the starter at right tackle. Dan Hampton moves out to the left end, replacing Hartenstein, with Michael and Dent continuing their spots. The linebackers, Wilson, Singletary, and Wilbur Marshall having a fine, fine year. Ken Taylor starting for the injured Mike Richardson with Frazier on the corners. Duerson and Fensick the safeties. Third down and a long 3, Green Bay.
The Bears are in their 46.
Clark tackled by Singletary, and initial contact underneath the stack there from Steve McMichael, number 76. And the Packers stopped short of the first down by about 2 yards. So the ball spotted at the 22, and Al Del Greco comes on the field. Steve McMichael, the 6-year man from Texas, like his coach Mike Ditka, says we take no prisoners. 40-yard attempt for Del Greco. They're going to spot it just at the 30-yard line. There is a breeze blowing. It looks to be more crossfield, but slightly behind Del Greco. Zorn will hold. And he's got it. Al Del Greco, his 8th field goal of the season, puts the Packers on top 3-0, converting the turnover on the fumble by Payton. Jim Ryan with Johnny Morris at Lambeau Field. The Green Bay Packers have stung the Bears, converting the turnover by Peyton into a three-point field goal by Al Del Greco. Well, the question of whether the emotions might run too high for the Packers may be moot, since they come up with a turnover and get on the scoreboard. If they needed settling down at all, that probably ought to do it, Johnny.
It certainly would. And Forrest Gregg says he really put his team on the spot. He says, we are up for this game. If we don't win it, we're not a good football team at all.
Del Greco's kicked off deeper this time. Back to the goal line. Will he go? He's got room. Nice diving tackle by Harlan Huckelby, with Galt going down at the 40-yard line. A 39-yard return for the Bears will have them good field goal position, and Huckelby might have saved a touchdown.
He certainly did, because Galt, as you know, went straight up and then turned to the left side and was just getting in gear, and Huckelby, 25, will come from the right of your screen as Galt was just turning it on and makes a big tackle there to prevent a possible touchdown. So the Bears have good field position.
Willie Galt comes out wide left. Wing formation right. Now a little shifting by the Bears. Moorhead moves over to make the strong side right. Suey and Peyton, the running backs. Passing on first down. Lots of time for McMahon. The screen set up. Suey with blockers. Good play by the Packers. A flag down. And John Anderson on the tackle got behind the blockers on the screen and dropped Suey. A gain of only a half yard. Flag on the play.
We have to give some credit to Charles Martin. He got over there from his nose tackle position and busted up the blocking.
And the Bears are penalized on the play. A holding signal from our referee today, Bob McElwee. We'll get the official call from him momentarily. Packers decide.
Illegal block above the waist. Number 63, offense.
Well, it's an illegal block, not a hold, by Jay Hilgenberg, the center, number 63.
And I think it was a block on Martin. You're going to see a 94 going over to break up the screen. There he is to the left of your screen. And 63, Hilgenberg kind of pushes him from the back. It was a really close call. It wasn't much contact, but then you can see the tackle there by Noble.
Packers take the 10 yards and will leave the Bears with a first and 20 from their own 30-yard line. Green Bay leads 3-0. 12:05 and counting in the first quarter at Lambeau Field. Temperature is going down into the low 40s now as the skies get a little darker. The lights are on. McKinnon in motion. They give it to Peyton. Peyton has blockers out the left side. Cuts inside the cornerback Lewis, but the filling job by the Packers is good. They hold him to about a 5-yard gain. It'll be second and 15 with Mossy Cade, the starter at strong safety today, making the tackle.
It's ironic. The only Chicago Bear that the Packers aren't mad at is Walter Payton. They said he never says anything and goes about and does his job. And we don't have anything against him. He says it's the rest of the team.
Yeah, but Ezra Johnson said he wasn't excluding Walter Payton from the contact that they expected to occur out here today. He said, well, yeah, Walter's a good guy, but he's a Bear.
Second and 15. Again, the shift, Moorhead to the strong side right. Cade is blitzing. Peyton cut inside him. Peyton with running room out the right side, and now forced out by Lee. Picked up about five, and Lee drove Peyton all the way over to the Bears bench. And there's a pile up there with flags flying. Mark Lee, number 22, taking Peyton all the way to the Bears bench. That is tough territory to be intruding on at this point, with tempers already frayed before this game even began.
Plus, to offend Walter Payton is a mistake, as we were talking about, because the Bears love to protect him. He's the guy that's the heart of the team, and that's something that can rile up the Chicago Bear offense, or in fact the entire team. So not a wise move by the Green Bay Packers.
The referee is number 95, Bob McElwee, and you see him discussing the play with his staff. I bet those officials got their game faces on today, knowing they were assigned to this game.
Personal foul, number 22, defense, 15 yards, first down.
Well, Johnny, that brings us back to what I asked you just moments ago. Does this emotional high that the Packers are on for this game, does it have the possibility of penalizing them when they pick up penalties on the field?
That's a very good point, and I was talking to Steve McMichael. Let's listen.
Personal foul, 22 defense. Player is disqualified.
Oh. Wow.
Now the Packers are hurting a defensive back anyway. They have two new safeties, and Mark Lee is one of their starting cornerbacks. Packers really be hurting because they had to activate Burgess, and they're really down to the bone when it comes to defensive backs.
They had already lost Mark Murphy and Mike McLeod to injuries from this game, and Tom Flynn. McLeod and Murphy unable to go today, with Murphy going onto the injured list, and with McLeod going on injured reserve. Tom Flynn with a sore ankle unable to start today, and with Lee out, Horace Gregg will now be down to Gary Hayes, a second-year man from Fresno State, on the corner, with just Ronnie Burgess, who was just activated this week as a reserve.
Well, the Packer fans don't like it, and you have to wonder. It's early in the game, and I mean, it's an important game, and it might be kind of a stiff penalty for a late hit, an awful stiff penalty to penalize him for the rest of the game. Let's take a look at it. The Packers blitzed here. Mossy Cade ran right out of the play as Peyton got some running room. Now 22 is Mark Lee, and he comes up here on the outside. Peyton heading for the sidelines.
To that point, and then they made it a little too good.
Well, I think Walter Payton gave him a little stiff arm too at the same time they got ticked off, but I don't know about disqualification.
Me neither. First down at the 45 to the air. McMahon and Willie Gault cannot hold on. Gary Hayes had the coverage on him, so they went right at Hayes, and Hayes gave Gault a little shove as they got up. This is going to be an acrimonious game. In fact, before the first game this season between these two teams, the Packer press release described the rivalry as one of the longest and most acrimonious in pro football, and we've seen evidence of it early here.
One of the quotes out of Chicago was from Jim McMahon, who confirmed it for us. He says that the Packers are a bunch of crybabies, and for a quarterback to say that, you've got to be a little bit cocky, right? Because somebody's going to get a shot at you sooner or later.
Nervy is definitely what McMahon is. Second and 10 from the Packer 45. The Pack leads 3-0. And McMahon ran right into the defender, John Anderson, the linebacker, who was sure pleased to have a clean shot at Jim McMahon. Intended pass with a coverage downfield. McMahon started to run with it.
And then he stopped running. As soon as he saw Anderson, boy, he headed for the turf. So he's a smart quarterback. At the same time, on the rollout with Michael Douglas, the blitzing, you can see it was an all-out blitz, and he just got under the hit by John Anderson. The Packers are really hurting defensively, physically. They have now three starters out in the defensive backfield. Now that's hurting.
And we just saw Brian Noble, the linebacker, come limping off. The rookie from Arizona State, there's Mark Lee on the sidelines. He will play no more today. Third and 15. In motion comes Gault out of the backfield in the shotgun formation. McMahon runs out of time, and he is sacked. And it is Charlie Martin with an extra shot. And the ball comes loose. Play is dead as it's taken to the end zone. But after Martin had made the sack, there was additional pushing and shoving. And now one must hope that this does not degenerate into a non-football game. The Packers, inspired with their emotion toward the Bears, have stopped them here, and the coaching staff is talking to Charlie Martin on the Packers sideline, trying to calm him down.
Well, they had their shot at Jim McMahon, as Mike Dick is the calmest player. He's not a player anymore. He's the calmest person on the sidelines, but he won't stay that way. He has got confidence in his team, and he says that he doesn't like the Packers. The Packers don't like him. He says he remembers the 60s, and he said everybody used to offend the Bears. He said, I'm tired of being offended. He said, the Bears are going to offend other people. If they don't like it, they can lump it. And that's basically, I'm paraphrasing, but that's what he said, and I'm not exaggerating.
Maury Buford will be the Bears punter as the loss dropped them back to the 44-yard line. Philip Epps, the deep man for the Packers. They've got a problem on punt returns and have used three different players there in the first half of the season. Buford hits from the 35. Short punt. It's bobbled by the Packers. Still loose. And it looks like Green Bay has retained possession. It was Gary Hayes who tried to field the ball on the short punt from Buford, and he was able to get a hold of it. So pretty good field position again for Green Bay at their own. Tim Ryan with Johnny Morris. Let's go back and look at that last sack with Charlie Martin getting to McMahon.
Martin got to the outside of Mark Bort, 62, and gets in the sack as Edward Johnson is wheeled out of the play. Now here comes the sack by Martin. and he gets down on McMahon. Now, is he celebrating or is he pounding on McMahon? What is he doing there? That's what ticked off Keith Van Horn, who came in and piled on.
So the Packers, with a 3-0 lead, have the ball at their own 33-yard line. They are a fired-up football team. That is obvious. Straight ahead is Eddie Lee Ivory. A flag on the play. Ivory got about two. Out the right side, where Hampton and Perry combined to put the stop on him. William Anthony Perry, 308-pound rookie, starting at defensive right tackle today. Offside is signaled against Green Bay. Or illegal motion, pardon me, is the signal against the Packers.
You know, the Bears have won 13 of their last 14 regular season games. The last game they lost was to the Green Bay Packers, 20-14 last year.
Illegal formation, six men on the line offense, 5 yards, still first down.
Well, it was a procedure call with the wrong number of people on the line, and Forrest Gregg not happy about that one.
He says, can't they count to seven? You got to have seven up there on that line of scrimmage. I think a key for Green Bay is going to be to control this ball, because the Bears eventually are going to be going after those new defensive backs, and the Packers are going to have to try and eat up this clock and prevent the Bears from having the ball. The Bears normally average 6 yards on first down, and that's devastating. So Green Bay's got to control with Jim Zorn.
Jim Zorn, the former Seattle quarterback, with his first start. They come out of the I formation on first and 15. Play action. Left-hander looking to throw, has time up the middle for Epps, incomplete. And behind Epps, tried to reach back for it, but the pass off target. Talking with Jim Zorn about his preparation this week, he feels that he's got a good grasp of the offense, but he was concerned, Johnny, about the terminologies. They have to call all of the individual plays involved in a given play for each player, and he was concerned about maybe calling a Seattle term in there somewhere, perhaps mixing up his teammates.
Paul Kaufman said, I'll keep him straight. If he calls me to do something wrong, I'll do it right anyway.
John Gale has come in defensively for the Chicago Bears on second and 15. Zorn, sideliner in the dirt, intended for Lofton, just never got the ball there. Gary Fenchick had come over on the coverage, and the Bears intending to double cover the dangerous James Lofton today, and at the same time help out their rookie cornerback Ken Taylor, who's playing for the injured Mike Richardson. Well, elsewhere in the NFL today, the Buccaneers and the Giants are tied at 3-3 in the first period, a key game in the NFC East for the Giants. Miami in front of New England, the struggling Dolphins leading. And Washington and Atlanta tied at 3 in the first period. Out of the shotgun on third down. Zorn gets time, gets the ball off for Preston Dennard, and Dennard does make the catch. The flag came down, but the catch will be good. Preston Dennard with Fenchick and Gale on the coverage.
He just out-muscled Sean Gale, as we have some fisticuffs going down at the other end of the field also. As the Bears put on the blitz that time, and actually Sean Gale had the interception, but give Dennard credit, 88. He went up and became a defender almost there and just muscled the ball away. And whenever in doubt, they give it to the offensive man, as Ron Hallstrom was upset in the Green Bay Packer offensive line. I think he feels that there were some shenanigans against Jim Zorn, so we'll have to see what's going on. You got to keep your eyes open. There's
That's
things happening
right.
all over this football
contact.
Field.
Number 21 defense, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 65 offense. Penalties offset.
Well, they'll replay the down. A tough break for the Packers there, as they had a first down with a 17-yard gain to their own 45, where Frazier was flagged for the Bears, but Hallstrom's penalty will negate it.
You know, more importantly, Jim Zorn has not thrown the ball well so far. I know it's early, but that time he threw into double coverage. They were lucky to get the reception out of it. So a key is going to be how he picks up the Bear defense. You know, it's a defense he hasn't played against for a long time, being at Seattle when he was on the bench, and he hasn't seen that 46 and all that weird stuff the Bears do. So he's really on the spot.
Jim Zorn will have third and 15. Ball at the Packer 26-yard line. Reggie Phillips in the backfield for the Bears now. Zorn out of the shotgun, has time, a good coverage downfield, and he'll take off. And he slides into the area where Otis Wilson is waiting. And yet another flag down on the play.
Yes, there was some contact between Reggie Phillips and the receiver. Whether they'll call it against the defense.
And they do.
I think it might be against 48. Reggie Phillips. I don't want to indict him before we get the official call.
Phillips, the rookie from
holding
SMU.
Number 48, defense, 5 yards, automatic first down.
Well, there's a big play defensively, the mistake by the Bears. The Packers get back what they lost on the penalty to Hallstrom after their first down pass to Preston Dennard. So they'll have the first down, but they will be at their 32-yard line.
I would imagine that the Packers will be going after Ken Taylor, the Bears cornerback, playing for Richardson. So far, they haven't really gone after him that much as the refrigerator comes in. Once again, number 72, William Perry. And you are seeing that Hampton is in the middle, and it looks like a 46 defense. The two linebackers on one side over here at the bottom of your screen.
Two tight ends in for the Packers. The rush is on from Hampton. He gets it off, and it's going to be picked off by Gary Fensick. Intended for Epps. Fensick running with it, but he was down. And the Bears come up with their turnover as Zorn, throwing down the center of the field, found Fensick there. And that is his fourth interception of the season.
Not only Fensick, but a whole bunch of Chicago Bears. There was one receiver, as Dan Hampton was putting pressure on, and three defenders. There was no chance for the reception here. Three on one. And Gary Fensick comes up with, I believe, his 34th career interception, only three shy of the Chicago Bear record. There's Jim Zorn saying, what am I doing? The Packers only sent one receiver down, still had trouble protecting the quarterback.
So Chicago trailing 3-0. They'll have the ball at their own 39-yard line. Moorhead sets up on the right side, the tight end, and now Suey shifting. He drops to Peyton. Peyton cuts it back inside, picks up about 3 yards, and a crushing block after Peyton was down by number 29, Ken Stills, the rookie from Wisconsin, putting a lick on Suey, and that brought flags everywhere. Ken Stills was a late cut in the training camp this year after being their eighth pick.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 29 defense, 15 yards, automatic first down.
Well, I think the Packers are losing some composure now. It's happened too many times in this football game. Stills getting a chance to play and overdoing it. 29 on 26. There was Suey, was just standing there watching the play, and Stills came in and just gave him a clobber. Just gave him a clobber, completely uncalled for. Thank you, says Matt Suey. I'll see you later in the game.
And meanwhile, for the Bears, a first down. And the ball will move now to the Packer 44-yard line. Ken Stills signed this week with these injuries to the secondary of the Packers. We've mentioned a couple of times, Murphy McCloud, Darrell Jones all hurt. And, of course, Mark Lee out of the game early here on a disqualification. Stills, the starter today for Flynn. He's in uniform but has a bad ankle. Short drop by McMahon. Intended out there for Whiteman, the tight end, and it is incomplete. Mossy Cade put a hit on him as the pass was high, tried to pull it down. Cade, timing it perfectly, put the bump on him and prevented the completion.
And that was a good hard hit by Mossy Cade. That time you can do it that the way, and that's the way you're supposed to do it. With the right receiver coming in, the tight end going out, the ball was there, you put the hit on him and he takes his punishment. Good hard legal football.
Mossy Cade was really looking forward to this. You know, he's never played strong safety or free safety through high school or college at University of Texas. Had a couple of practices this week starting on Wednesday. But yesterday told us, hey, I'm excited about this. I'm looking forward to the contact. I like contact. I expect to be dealing with tight ends and fullbacks, and I'm looking forward to it. And he'll be dealing with Walter Payton, who picks up about 3. Tripped up by Charlie Martin. He'll leave a 3rd and 7. Forrest Gregg saying that Cade was the logical choice from what he had left to take over that safety spot. He's 6'1", 195 pounder, and he's got good speed.
Okay, now take a look at Charlie Martin. He's 74. He's the nose guy's guard. Now watch him get over there, and he's the key to stopping this play. He's a mobile nose man. He plays off the block, gets by Hilgenberg, 94 right there, and gets on the tackle and ends up hitting Walter Payton. Good play.
4 wide receivers on 3rd down for the Bears. Marjoram and Anderson join McKinnon and Gault. And a little flip inside to Willie Gault. Gault trying to get to the first down. He will be close. Willie Gault tackled by Anderson, number 59. And a flag again on the play.
And it is against the Bears. Apparently an illegal motion penalty.
We better start checking our record books. We may have a penalty record by the time this football game is over, as Mike Ditka trying to figure out what went wrong.
So far, all of the first downs have come on penalties.
He's saying, take that penalty, take that penalty. I wouldn't think that.
Well, they're going to measure to see if he had the first down yardage, and it does look from our vantage point as though they have the yardage. So then the Packers will decide.
You might have to. I'm not sure the Bears would they'd go for a field goal or. It is a first down. Now it's going to be an interesting
call. Ineligible downfield. Number 74 offense. Penalty will be accepted as first down was made on the play.
So apparently Jim Covert was called as an ineligible receiver downfield on the play.
You know, I think I would have taken that penalty anyway, even if it wasn't a first down, because at fourth on about the 33-yard line, the half a yard to go, you probably would want not want to give the Bears that opportunity. But it's a moot point now. It's going to be a third down situation once again.
That might have been a Perry play for the Bears.
That's right. William Perry may have come in, and you know what happened with George Cumbie.
George is tired of hearing about that, too.
William Perry has got to be the heaviest man to ever score a touchdown in the NFL.
Yeah, I guess so. Everybody's gone back to Bingaman and Motley and Pete Johnson and all of the big guys anybody can ever remember were carrying the ball at any time, anyway. But I think you're right. In the poundage category, he's got to be the record holder for scoring the touchdown. All right, it is third down for the Bears back at the 49-yard line of Chicago. It is third and 17. Five defensive backs, Ronnie Burgess, number 39, in the secondary of the Packers. And early movement by Green Bay. They hand it off to Walter Payton, and he's got some running room up the sideline. Close to the first down marker, is knocked out of bounds by Gary Hayes, number 27. But again, a flag. We've had a flag on nearly every play. 16-yard run by Payton. Alfonso Carriker, number 76, playing with the broken left hand and a cast, was the man over a little early, and that is the preliminary signal offside.
Offside, number 76, defense. Penalty is declined, fourth down.
Now, Jim McMahon has a knack of getting teams offsides. He changes his cadence and emphasizes the wrong hut sometimes, and the defenses, the Packers, were working on that this week to not be fooled by the inflection of his voice. But
all right, William Perry is coming in now because they've got that fourth and short that we were just talking about. Robert Payton has rolled up 33 yards already, by the way, on six carries, approaching the 14,000-yard mark in his career. But William Perry, as the Packer fans say, they're going to unplug the refrigerator today.
The Packers are confused on defense, have had to call a timeout, deciding on how they're going to handle this.
Now, right now, they've got Shoemate and Humphrey and Prather out there, but in watching them practice as they take a timeout, we did not see them doing anything special with a big man. It looked like Cumbie was going to be in the same position as the linebacker, and his plan was simply to get low on Perry. Let's see what they do. We'll be back at Lambeau Field with 6-12. Tim Ryan with Johnny Morris back at Lambeau Field, and this is like watching two hockey coaches set up for a face-off. They've changed their personnel entirely. Suey's back in, and Perry's gone out.
And so what did the Bears profit? They had the Packers call a timeout, so they got some profit out of it.
Well, let's see what they do. It is fourth and one inside the 35 of Green Bay. Play action. The pass to Colt, almost intercepted. Perfect defensive play by Mossy Cade.
Packer fans and the Packers will take it. However, Mossy Cade almost had himself an interception. He puts the jam on. He didn't quite see the ball in time there. He put his hand out. It could have gone right down the sidelines, but it was a great play by Mossy Cade, who is doing pretty well. Just think, he has not played at strong safety in the history of his career.
So the Packers elude 3-0 takeover at their own 35-yard line. Jesse Clark, the lone setback. Jim Zorn, the quarterback. West is set up on the wing right. They give it to Clark. Clark breaks through traffic, but a diving tackle by Mike Singletary. Just as he saw some daylight, Singletary slashed across to pull him down by the ankles. The gain will be about a yard or two.
Mike Singletary, number 50, taking the signals in from the sidelines. The man who makes the Bear defense go.
Boy, intensity has become such an overworked word in the lexicon of sports, but it is personified in its real sense by Mike Singletary. Second and nine. Zorn on a straight drop, under pressure from McMichael. The pass to the tight end, Kaufman, incomplete. And Kaufman complaining about the tight coverage by Wilbur Marshall, by Singletary.
Well, that time the Packers had the situation they wanted. They had Kaufman man for man on number 50, the middle linebacker, Mike Singletary, and he was behind him. But with the lax rules now for the defenders, as long as he turns his head back, he's supposed to be able to dive into the player.
Not sure he did there.
I'm not sure he did that.
He had an arm on Kaufman and was looking upfield, so the Packers may have a gripe.
I think Kaufman has a legitimate beef on that play.
Sean Gale is in the lineup. Blake Moore has come in at center for the shotgun snapping, as has been the case for several weeks for the Pack. Zorn gets time, and the pass might have been deflective. Otherwise, it was just a bad throw intended for Phillip Epps. And Zorn looking unhappy as Epps was open out there in the left flat, and Zorn couldn't get him the ball.
I think what you're seeing is the effect of a quarterback who just has not played very much. And the Bears only had a four-man rush, but take a look at the shot that he took.
It looked like the linebacker, Wilson.
Otis Wilson. It was a four-man rush, three linemen and one linebacker.
It is fourth down, with the punter, Joe Prokop, making his first appearance at the Packer 20-yard line. Ken Taylor, the rookie, now playing the cornerback position for the injured Mike Richardson, waiting for the punt at the Bear 22-yard line. Short punt, taken on the fly by Taylor. Taylor up the sideline, gets over to the 42-yard line of Chicago. John Dorsey, reserve linebacker number 99, on the tackle. A 34-yard punt, which has been a problem here in Green Bay, and a 12-yard return. Jim Ryan with Johnny Morris at Lambeau Field. Still 5:07 to play first quarter. We've had eight penalties slowing the game down. Neither quarterback has been able to get much going. In fact, we have not yet had a completed pass. Bears first down from their own 40-yard line following Ken Taylor's punt return. Payton, he gets a good hole on left tackle and picks up about seven, driven out by Gary Hayes, Ken Stills, number 29 for the Green Bay Packers. That rush by Walter Payton put him over the 14,000 mark for his career. 14,001, 40 yards on the day. Payton again, dropped for a loss. Big defensive play by Randy Scott, a flag down that appeared to come after the play. Scott just blew through there and met Payton in the backfield.
So Walter Payton is back under 14,000 yards. He's got 13,999 yards.
And a discussion with the Packers, so the penalty apparently against the Bears.
Well, that was a heck of a play by
holding
Scott.
Number 26, offense.
Matt Suey charged with the holding. And the defensive unit of the Green Bay Packers has stymied the Bears thus far.
Payton says he'll soon have to have his 15,000-mile checkup. You imagine that, 14,000 yards?
I wonder how many pairs of shoes that adds up to.
Well, he's got about 30 in his locker. 30 pairs of shoes just for this season.
It is second down and 13. Moorhead lines up on the left side. Straight drop. And lots of time. No rush at all. Out in the flat to Suey. Suey has the first down, Chicago, to the 47-yard line of Green Bay. A 16-yard gain. Pretty good coverage downfield. It appeared that one Bear, McKinnon, was open deep, but McMahon went to the release man.
And there was good coverage for the quarterback. Take a look at the Packer rush. Only a three-man rush, and nobody got near McMahon. He had all day to throw the ball. Sui just kind of dipped out in the flat. He was a safety valve receiver and takes the pass. And since there was no pass rush, you know you had more people down covering. So this is we'll see if the Packers are going to do this all day with not too many blitzes and giving you the short pass.
With 4 minutes left in the quarter, that is the first pass completion today. First down, Chicago, in Packer territory. They trail 3-0.
Blitz.
Again, time. Deep for McKinnon, and it is incomplete. Gary Hayes had the coverage on McKinnon. The pass overthrown, and Hayes was step for step with McKinnon. In fact, he was about 2 yards deeper than Dennis McKinnon. So Gary Hayes, who had to come in for Mark Lee, who was thrown out of the game on the first offensive series by the Bears for driving Walter Payton into the bench. Gary Hayes does the job on coverage.
Let's get some scores from around the league. Nothing, Kansas
that's
City, Houston.
Score.
Yeah, that's a close one, though. And Buffalo 7-0 over Cincinnati second quarter. Pittsburgh losing to Cleveland 3-0 second quarter. So it looks like some low-scoring games so far.
Well, we've got one going here. Second and 10. Slot formation left. They give to Payton. Payton off tackle, finds running room, has a first down, Chicago. Inside the 35, tackled by John Anderson. Got a good block by Sui, and Walter Payton adjusts his pads. Now has 52 yards on 8 carries.
You said it was a good block by Sui. Let's watch him as he'll lead the way here and throw a block right in this area on the linebacker. Take a watch, a look at Matt Sui. Don't watch Walter Payton. Watch Matt Sui, number 26, as he goes through the hole, and there comes the block there. I didn't quite make out who it was. It looked like it might have been... couldn't quite tell, but it was a heck of a block. Let's say he blocked King Kong, okay?
I think it was Randy Scott, number 55, but our picture is a little fuzzy. First down, they're at the 35 of Green Bay. They fake the draw. McMahon gets it away, and three Packers pound him. The ball goes out of bounds. And Anderson, Brown, and Johnson all got a piece of Jim McMahon in the Bear backfield.
Well, you got to give McMahon some... points for courage. He stayed there to the last second to try and finally get rid of the pass, and it was John Anderson and
Robert Brown. And
Robert
Johnson.
Brown.
Yep.
And Johnson, too. They were all in there.
McMahon is one of seven for 16 yards, and Zorn is yet to hit on five.
Well, you can understand Zorn a little bit more because he hasn't played very much. McMahon is the number one rated quarterback in the league, so.
The Pack has had a good rush on it. Payton. Payton, nice piece of running by Walter Payton, dancing his way over the 30 to the 28-yard line of Green Bay. Ezra Johnson ranged back from defensive end, number 90, to make the tackle, and it'll leave third down and 3 for Chicago.
You know, Ezra Johnson has really come on to be the leader for Green Bay, especially this week. He said he's played a lot of games against the Bears, and this is one he wants more than anyone that he's ever played. You know, that's saying something. Ezra Johnson.
He underlined the word hate in our discussion with Ezra. He said, we hate them. We're angry, and we're going to go out and beat them. Third down. Whoops, missed you. McMahon tripped up and then buried. They steal the ball from him, but the play over. Douglas and Scott put the hit on him. And whether he stumbled on his own or whether a Packer hand tripped him up, we may be able to see on the replay.
And this is the case. There was a little mix-up on the play there, and then he stumbles coming out. This is where the Packers had their free shot. Here comes Douglas, 53, and Scott, 55. They had their free shot at the quarterback, and McMahon pushes back there a little bit, and Douglas gets into it with McMahon. Michael Douglas, who has something to prove this week. You know, he is, you've heard all the stories about the situation last weekend in the locker room, and he was being criticized, and there was a fight. There hasn't been too much said about it, but he did say to me yesterday that the Packer coaches apologized this week after they looked at the game films, that he had played a good game, and that he had a right to defend himself. So sometimes things are set in motion when you lose, like they lost to Indianapolis.
Oh, yeah, it was an upsetting loss. Hey, they had their butts kicked, 37-10. Buford will punt. for the Bears. Angling for the corner. Down there is Gentry and Sean Gale. And did they keep it out? Yes, they did. Sean Gale downing the ball, and they're going to spot it. Well, one official may give it the Gentry spot. No, it's going to be Gale's spot at the 4-yard line. So Green Bay will be starting from their end zone. And we want to remind you that next week CBS Sports presents doubleheader action. Your area will receive one of the following important matchups. The Lions at 5-3. They're playing Minnesota today against the unbeaten Bears, who may or may not be at the end of this day. The Rams and the Giants, a big battle. And Green Bay at Minnesota, St. Louis at Tampa Bay. The doubleheader action, Dallas and Washington. One of the great rivalries in the NFL. And clearly a very big game for the Redskins, which may be more so depending on the outcome of their game today. Check your local listings for the game in your area preceding our doubleheader action. First down from the 4-yard line of Green Bay. High formation. Eddie Lee Ivory, another flag is down. And it is Harry who made the tackle on Ivory after a gain of about 3 yards. 1 minute, 11 seconds remaining in this first period, and the preliminary signal against the Packers.
Well, they couldn't be penalized too much.
Holding number 57, offense, half the distance to the goal line, still first down.
That is rookie guard Rich Moran from San Diego State. Had been getting some time last week for Keith Uecker, and Uecker playing hurt, wound up for going on to injured reserve. And we expect to see Ken Rutgers, the other rookie in this game, as Forrest Gregg told us that he wanted to get his number one pick from USC some time in Carl Swanky's spot at left tackle. First down and 12 from the 2. Clark plows out to the 5-yard line, a gain of 3 on the play. Singletary and William Anthony Perry made the tackle. Bears defensive unit a little surprised that Perry was made a starter this week. Dan Hampton and Steve McMichael feeling that, hey, you don't touch a good thing. Here's the Bears defense doing a fine job again this year, not ranked number one as they were much of last year. But with the Mike Hartenstein being benched from his starting role in favor of William Perry, they tactic being that they hope to get a better rush from the outside with Hampton playing out at left end. And Hampton got a lick on that ball carrier. The naked Otis Wilson who made that contact as Jesse Clark took quite a rap, was spun into the traffic, got the ball out to about the 9-yard line. We'll leave 3rd and 5. And time expires here. In the first period, it's been a long first quarter with the penalties, and the Packers continue to hold the lead. They scored on their first series. They lead 3-0.
Tough situation to be passing against the Bears.
3rd down and 5 from the 9-yard line of Green Bay. Zorn from the goal line takes a hit. The pass is caught by Kaufman. A battle for the loose ball. Singletary on the coverage, and it will be Green Bay ball. What a catch by Kaufman. Singletary is furious. He says he made the intercept. A 22-yard first down play. A flag down after the play was whistled dead.
Well, Mike, Singletary is upset, but it did appear that Kaufman had the ball, went down, hit the turf, and then he yanked the ball out afterwards. And a penalty. It was into double coverage. They had him well covered. Jim Zorn was got the ball off. As you're going to take a look at Kaufman with Wilbur Marshall, he put a good move on Wilbur Marshall, who's covering downfield number 58 and number 50 Singletary, two linebackers on the coverage on the tight end. Now they have the coverage, but Kaufman just went up, took the ball. He's down. He's got the ball at this point, and then it is kind of, there it is under his foot. It's kind of hard to tell, but it looked like when it came down, he had the ball.
Yes, he did, and that's what the officials ruled, that the play was over, that he was down with the ball, with the completion, and when it came loose, Singletary grabbed it and thought it should be a fumble.
Well, sometimes they try and cover Kaufman with one linebacker. That time, they used two.
So the Packers get upfield out from the shadow of their end zone and have it at the 46-yard line. Loose ball. Zorn able to recover it, but there'll be a loss of a yard on the play. Mark Cannon, the center, number 58, and Jim Zorn, the quarterback, having a bit of a problem on the exchange. Steve McMichael burying Zorn after he covered the football. So Jim Zorn, while he has yet to be sacked, has been knocked down a couple of times after he released the ball and has been under some pressure with three hurries on him.
The Packers have been trying to establish a running game. Of course, the Bears are number one in the NFL against the run. So the better time to throw on them is on first down and second down.
Second and 11 with a slot formation left for Green Bay. One setback.
217! 217!
Jesse Clark with another flag down. Picks up about 3 yards near the 49-yard line of Green Bay. Dan Hampton on the tackle. We had 8 penalties in the first period, and we've had 2 flags here already in the second. The illegal motion, the signal against Green Bay. The Pack had 4 penalties for 37 yards in the first quarter, and the Bears 4 for 35.
Illegal motion, number 67, offense. Penalty is declined, third down.
So the Bears decline it. We'll leave third and 11. I'll make it third on the gain by Clark. It'll make it third and 7.
I wonder if James Lofton is going to become a factor in this game. They double cover him a lot, but a lot of times you can beat double coverage. You know, you get in between the zone and stuff like that, and Lofton is their biggest threat, and I think they got to try him a little bit.
The penalty count to the moment has been a factor in this football game, certainly in the score and in the length of time to play the first quarter. Out of the shotgun, Blake Moore, the snap to Zorn. Zorn gets good protection. Sideliner complete to Epps. Epps down the sideline and driven out at about the 21-yard line. Flags are down, however. Once more, back at the line of scrimmage. Sean Gale drove him out. And Philip Epps, with that dangerous sprinter speed, got down the sideline after shaking away from the cover man, who I believe was the rookie Ken Taylor, but it looks like it's going to come all the way back.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, 67 offense. Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, 95 defense. Penalties offset, free play the down.
Wow, well, there's just another example, Johnny, of how the tempers are hurting both teams, but particularly the Packers. Here's a big play for Green Bay, and because of a squabble between Swanky and Dent, that play goes for naught. They're still back at third down.
And that's twice happened to Green Bay on key plays where penalties have negated the play, so.
And that's one where you've got both teams involved, and yet the Packers wind up with a 31-yard play wiped out. Packers have been tough at home. They've won 3 out of the last 4 against Chicago here at home. They're 3-5 on the season against the unbeaten Bears. Epps and Denard, wide receiver. Lots of time for Zorn. Zorn's pass complete, and it's Epps again. Epps again eluding the defenders and gets to the 30-yard line. Big play by Zorn and Philip Epps. First down at the Bears 30. No flags down yet. 21 yards.
And they're working on Ken Taylor. He's the cornerback playing as Epps goes down. Look at the room that Taylor gives him. And then the biggest mistake, he comes up and he's got to go for that man and make that tackle. Great play by Epps as he cuts back and gets downfield for the first down. Philip Epps, who had a big play last week against Indianapolis, called back that end around. So if Philip Epps can become a part of this offense, it'll take a lot of pressure off of James Lofton, who's getting doubled quite a bit. Packers on the move, and Zorn seems to be warming up a little bit.
Epps had 20 catches coming into the game, to 40 by Lofton. Lofton has continued to be their main man, but Epps may be the faster of the two. They can both fly. First down at the 30-yard line. Eddie Lee Ivory comes in motion off the wing. Now, there's an interesting play, but flags are everywhere. They had Eddie Lee Ivory come in motion off the wing all the way out to the near sideline. Like to have seen that play finish. But it's illegal motion, a false start charged against Swanky. So the play does not develop at all.
So Swanky may be another player that's a little overexcited. He's been involved in a couple of them right now in the last couple of minutes. So there's no question, we had the game pegged right, it was going to be an emotional football game. Gee,
that's the 10th penalty. Five to each team. First and 15. And again, Ivory lined up on the wing left. The lone setback is Jesse Clark. And here comes Ivory in motion again. They go to Clark inside. He is buried at the line. William Perry was there. And Steve McMichael, number 76. There'll be no gain on forward progress. It'll be right at the line of scrimmage, so it'll still be first and 15.
William Perry getting some more playing time. He's not on the kick teams now because he's getting to play steadily. He will be possibly in on offense. But Mike Ditka says he's too good a football player. We've got to get him in the lineup. And there he is, number 72. He's got more commercial opportunities in the last week than the man in the moon.
I spoke with his agent about that just a couple of days ago, and we'll tell you about what's happening with the refrigerator. Second and 15. Zorn intended for Eddie Lee Ivory out of the backfield, but off the mark. It'll leave third and 15. I spoke with Jim Steiner, who handles Perry, as we see Jim Zorn saying, yep, bad throw on my part, Eddie. And he said he's had a call one every 10 minutes since that San Francisco game that brought Perry to national prominence. And he's had an assortment of offers, everything from dentists who want to fix the gap in his front teeth so he'll look prettier in his posters, all the way down to refrigerator companies who naturally want him to endorse their product, T-shirts, posters, toy robots, all those things you might expect.
And he says he can spike a basketball any way you want it.
Third down and 15. Three wide receivers for the Packers. Pressure. Hampton has Zorn. The sack back to the 45-yard line of the Bears. And it'll be fourth down.
Dan Hampton, who played defensive end, he's played defensive tackle and back at defensive end. Blake Moore is one of the blockers on the situation, along with Rich Moran, and 99 just gets through them both and just puts the sack on Jim Zorn. So the Packers are going to have to punt.
That gives Hampton 3.5 sacks on the season. He's not so much unhappy about being out at left end because he thinks it might protect his long legs a little more than the action he gets inside. But he did say, nonetheless, that they were surprised that Perry has become a starter halfway through a successful season. Pocock hitting from the 45-yard line. It is Dennis McKinnon at his own 9. McKinnon gets out to the 13-yard line of the Bears. And we have 10:46 remaining in the first half at Lambeau Field. The Packers 3, the Bears nothing. Tim Ryan with Johnny Morris here at Lambeau Field, where the Chicago Bears will have to start from their 14-yard line following the Packer punt. And they trail 3-0. On first down, the Bears have been averaging 6.1 yards coming into today's game. Today, they are a yard .8.
Galt's in the backfield in motion now.
Ball in motion out to the left. Fake to Payton. The pass to Moore to Galt. Incomplete. Looked like both receivers were expecting to get a shot at that ball. The deep man Galt went diving to try and catch it, and he's getting up slowly. Emery Moorhead, when he saw the ball in his flight path, tried to make a grab on it. And Galt being assisted off.
Actually, you end up with two receivers and almost in the same spot. It's hard to tell who McMahon was throwing to, as both of them came very close to it, but Galt was injured as he hit the turf there, and I think he might have knocked the wind out, or maybe it seemed to be holding his stomach.
McMahon, 1 of 8, the league's leading passer, 16 yards, has been sacked 3 times. Second and 10.
Kenny Marjoram in.
Marjoram for Galt. Short drop by McMahon. Gets it out to the tight end. That's Moorhead. Moorhead has a first down. Driven out at the 34-yard line. Make it the 35. A 21-yard gain. Randy Scott and Ken Stills on the tackle.
The linebackers didn't get out in that time because the wide receiver will come across from the right ear screen, the tight end on just kind of a fly out into the flat, and there was a mistake on the coverage because Moorhead is all by himself. All of a sudden, you'll see a bunch of linebackers come in on the coverage, but there was a mistake by Green Bay in that defensive backfield.
It is first down, Chicago, at their own 35-yard line. Marjoram out to the right. McKinnon left. Suey and Peyton in the backfield. McKinnon in motion. Pitch to Peyton. Peyton with a good hold. Breaks a tackle. And gets a first down to the 46-yard line of the Bears. Tripped up by Mossy Cade. 12-yard gain for Peyton, who now has 70 yards in this first half.
And that's a lot of yards. He also now has 106 touchdowns, fourth on the all-time list. He recently passed a former great Packer, Don Hudson. Walter Peyton, 10 rushes for 70. You double that, and that's 140 yards, and the game is not even halfway old yet.
First down from Chicago's 47-yard line. Peyton again dances outside. Douglas catches up with him. Ball came loose, but play whistled dead. Packers came up with the football, but the play was over. Mossy Cade picked it up. We've had two or three of those today where the ball has come loose just after the whistle is blown.
Good linebacker play by the linebackers, Michael Douglas and Randy Scott. You'll see over here, they'll come up and they will meet the charge of Matt Suey, who will come to lead the blocking. Now watch the linebackers jam up the blocking. As they come through here, there's Douglas and Randy Scott, 53 and 55. Peyton, such a great running back, dips outside the jam up, and Douglas, 53, continued his pursuit and got in on the tackle. Good hustle by Michael Douglas.
Second down and five. In Packer territory at the 48. Suey, met by Brian Noble, the rookie linebacker. Douglas forced him wide. Noble cleaned him up, the rookie from Arizona State. Loss on the play of two.
Well, the Packer defense may be banged up, but they're sure playing spirited football. At the beginning of the game, it was a little bit too spirited, but it seemed like things are settling down a little bit for that defense.
Tom Flynn has come into the secondary for the first time today, and Ronnie Burgess in on this passing situation as well. Brad to the right comes Brad Anderson. Bears with four wide receivers in. Willie Gault lined up in the backfield with McMahon and Peyton. They give it to Willie Gault. Galton trying to get outside, cannot do it. It was John Anderson. The Packers read it well, and they stuffed him. A gain of maybe a yard at most. It'll be fourth down.
Great play by John Anderson, who had nine tackles. As you can see, he's got that sore thumb, a man who's broken his arm three times. They saw Gault in the backfield, and I think that signaled to them what they were going to do. They watched Willie Gault, 83, come on the inside handoff, and not only was it Anderson, but it was Ezra Johnson, 59. You can see Hayes, everybody was over there. That play was really defensed well by the Packers.
He was the big man last week against Indianapolis in the losing cause, leading the team in tackles. A steady performer for them. Buford. That punt will go into the end zone and through. And Green Bay will start from their 20-yard line. 7:22 remains in the first half, and the Packers lead on Al Del Greco's field goal. Tim Ryan and Johnny Morris back at Lambeau Field. The only score, the field goal by Del Greco, that came on the first offensive series of the Bears. They fumbled the ball, Peyton did. And Del Greco kicked the field goal as Ken Rutgers, the number one pick from USC, has come in at left tackle, replacing Carl Swanke. Rutgers' first appearance. And 7:22 to play first half. In motion comes Jesse Clark off the wing. The pitch is to Ivory. Gets away from Dent. Ivory dancing away from Perry out to the 30-yard line. He'll have a first down, Green Bay. Sean Gale and Leslie Frazier made the tackle. Gale came in to replace Ken Taylor, the rookie at left corner, in Richardson's spot.
Watch number 95, Richard Dent. He comes across, gets across on the block, comes outside, and he thinks he has him dead to right, but a nice move back into the inside. Dent misses the tackle, and they wind up with one of their better runs of this afternoon.
At the 30-yard line, after an 11-yard pickup, first down, Green Bay. Clark in motion. Ivory again. Ivory smacked by Singletary. A gain of about three with Wilbur Marshall in on it, number 58.
Boy, this rivalry goes back a long ways. The Bears have won 69 games, the Packers 55, and there have been six ties. It started out with the old Acme Packers against the Decatur Staleys.
The Staleys start.
You remember that first game?
Oh, sure I do. I remember it well. It was a cold day.
You can bet it was cold.
The Staleys beat the Acme Packers 20-0. Remember it well. Second down. And seven to go. Green Bay. Zorn gets some time. Intended for Lofton. Incomplete. Zorn just kind of let that one fly. And Lofton, looking outside for the ball, just saw it go out of bounds. Zorn looking for the signal now this time. I guess they had a discussion of whether to shuttle plays in or signal them in for Zorn. It was interesting for Forrest Gregg to tell us that they would talk about that before the game and let the quarterback decide today what he was more comfortable with. There's Forrest, so it may develop that they're doing some of each.
Well, the Packers with a 3-5 record, if they lose this game, any kind of a chance for a wild card would probably be out the window.
Third and seven, Green Bay. Slot formation right. Blitz. Zorn gets time, trying to find a receiver. Goes to the short man, Clark, and it is incomplete. Most of the receivers were working the other side of the field, it appeared. Zorn rolled out to his left, found nobody open downfield. So Green Bay will have to punt. Well, we see the Tampa Bay Buccaneers ahead of the Giants 10-6 in the second quarter.
Miami has the lead over New England 10-3. That also is in the second quarter. Houston 6-0 over Kansas City. The Oilers are starting to come to life. Look at Washington 24-3 over Atlanta. And Buffalo 10-6 over Cincinnati second quarter.
Joe Prokop hits it from his 24-yard line. A short punt. Bearcat single by Taylor at the Bears' 35-yard line. So good field position. A 32-yard punt. Some boos from the Packer unfaithful here. Prokop's been having his problems. First down Bears at their own 35-yard line. They trail 3-0. McMahon is 2 of 9 for 37 yards. Play action. Sails it out to Suey. Not a good pass. He sidearmed it with the rush coming just as he unloaded from Brown and Donnie Humphrey, number 79. Humphrey, the second-year man from Auburn, getting some defensive time. Forrest Gregg has been using all six of his down linemen in one formation or another.
That's the elevator. That's the Packers' name for Donnie Humphreys. He says he wants a piece of the refridge before this game is over.
A big part of the Bears' offense has been to throw successfully on first down. McMahon is 0 for 7 in that department today. Marjoram and McKinnon, the wide receivers, second and 10. Walter Payton. Payton almost got loose. He has a first down at midfield. He has been what there has been of the Bears' offense today. Gary Hayes on the tackle, 90 yards for Payton.
And he simply broke some tackles as three or four men got a hand on him. Brian Noble, 91. You'll see him come across, and he's the man that had the shot at him. 91 right there. He breaks that tackle and then turns on up the field. And they tried to strip the ball, and finally Michael Douglas is in on the tackle along with Hayes. But you're right. That's been the Bear offense. Walter Payton, shades of the late 70s and the early 80s.
When they were losing. First down at midfield. Moorhead in motion off the wing. Matt Suey behind Payton. He picks up four. Tripped up by Tim Lewis, the third-year man from Pittsburgh, watching the pack in practice the other day. Well, let's take a look at this play.
Let's take a look at Emery Moorhead. He's the man that goes in motion, and he'll come across here and throw the block on 53, Douglas, and then Douglas gets up. But you can see the tight end was the key man to help Payton get his 4 yards. But Douglas, with great efforts, watch 87, and he's going to block on 53. He dumps Douglas right there. Now 53 gets back up. Michael Douglas, 53, gets over and actually ends up getting in on the tackle. Good play on both ends.
Second down and six. Walter Payton inside has a first down. Driven down from behind by Douglas with Brian Noble in on it as well, number 91, but another Bear first down. And that's 100 yards on the day.
Brian Noble, 91, has got to be frustrated. Here's another time he had a shot at Walter Payton. Coming from the left, 91. to hit Walter Payton right there. He's got to get him in those kind of situations, and Payton just bounced off it and got an extra 4 or 5 yards. The greatest runner ever to play this football game, in my opinion.
First down at the 36-yard line of Green Bay. The Bears with what looks like their first drive underway, and it's all been due to Walter Payton. Payton again. This time he's met by Donnie Humphrey, but still drives for about 3 yards out the left side.
Walter Payton shares the all-time record for rushing yardage in Lambeau Field, 205 yards. He set it a few years ago against Green Bay to tie a record held by Gale Sayers. 17 years ago today, Gale Sayers rushed for 205 yards, and a few years later, it was Walter Payton matching that with 205, and he's on that pace right now.
And it is his 68th 100-yard game in his distinguished career. Second and eight, Chicago, two tight ends, Moorhead and Reichman in. Good drop, pass out to Reichman. Reichman is pulled down by Mossy Cade, but he has the Bear first down. 12-yard gain for Tim Reichman. Drafted back in 82, went to the USFL. Here he is.
Okay, you see Mossy Cade, he's the new strong safety. He puts the jam on Reichman. Reichman pushes off and goes to the outside, and it's almost impossible to stop that pattern if you let the tight end get a step on you to the outside. Tim Reichman, 10 receptions, 187 yards, has done a good job whenever he's had a chance to get in there. But, you know, overall, Mossy Cade's not doing a bad job in there, considering he's on the spot.
I think he's been remarkable because haven't been able to detect him badly out of position on any play yet. And a timeout on the field with 2 minutes remaining in the first half. The Bears driving, the Packers leading. Packer backers from Kenosha are here in force today, with the Packers leading 3-0 in just 2 minutes remaining in the first half. And coming up at halftime, Brandon Erb will be joined by Dan Dierdorf in our studios in New York. The NFL Today will bring you up to date on scores and highlights, and a special look at the soaring Eagle defense. Now, that's not a formation. That's the Philadelphia Eagles defense, which has been doing an outstanding job, especially since Ron Jaworski has come back to become the starter. The Eagles making things difficult for everybody in the NFC East, and now even at 4-4 in the thick of it. First down, Bears. At the 23-yard line of Green Bay. Moorhead in motion. Payton back the other way. And good defensive work. Ezra Johnson trailed them all away, and Mike Douglas would not let him turn it upfield. On the 15-yard line, Bears trail 3-0. They haven't done anything offensively until this drive. Payton blasts his way over the 10 to about the 8-yard line. Green Bay defense has been tenacious and fired up from the start of this football game. They have shut down the Bears' passing game, but they haven't been able to stop Payton on this drive.
That was straight ahead, one-on-one blocking, nothing fancy, as Mark Bortz provided the key block.
First and goal from the 9. Mark Bortz, a new proud father, first baby born. He and his wife Lisa. Boy, 6 pounds, 9 ounces.
48 seconds.
First and goal. Lots of time for McManus. Flag down. Intended for Matt Sui. It is tipped away incomplete. And a flag on the play before he released the football. Donnie Humphrey had the pressure on him. Let's see what happened if somebody jumped a little early.
Green Bay was offsides.
Offside, number 79, defense, still first down.
Well, that was Humphrey, number 79.
You can see him. He's right over the center, number 79. He's in actually for Charles Martin right now, and he jumps across, and that's what I was talking about a little bit earlier. McMahon has that way of calling the signals that the defenses are starting to get leery of, because he emphasizes the wrong hut. Like, say it's a hut, it's on 4. He'll go hut, 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 and then hut. You see what I mean? He's trying to pull the defense off, and
it
works.
Illegal?
No, it is not illegal. It is not illegal. I'll explain that later.
We are inside the 5-yard line of the Packers, first and goal. 41 seconds. The Chicago Bears trailing 3-0, trying to get to the end zone. Another big defensive play. Payton shook away from number 29 Stills, but Stills nonetheless made it possible for his mates to stop Peyton from going into the end zone. Perry in motion. The pass to Perry. Touchdown. High fives from Walter Payton for William Perry, who's now a pass receiver.
Unbelievable. He goes in motion. They figured he's going to turn up for a block. He just takes off and completely fooled the Green Bay Packers. And the key to William Perry was hang on to that ball, and they didn't even spike it. William Perry scores his second touchdown, his first as a pass receiver. Cumbie, 52, is chasing him over there, but he gets caught up in the action there. And Perry, and the thing you lose sight of, is that he's very quick for such a big man for a first 5 or 10 yards. He has quickness.
Kevin Butler for the point after. Fuller will hold. And it is good. So the Bears go 65 yards in 11 plays, and what a climax. A pass to a 308-pound receiver by the name of William Anthony Perry. You saw that little burst of quickness you described, Johnny, just as he made his turn upfield, and he can catch the football.
I know that's got to be a record. Has any 308-pound receiver caught a touchdown?
I doubt it.
If they have, I'll tell you, it was back in 1761 with it. Somebody else.
The refrigerator evidently can do it all.
The key here was they tricked George Cumbie. Poor George Cumbie. Because he's coming across as he was in motion, and he gets caught up in the situation. Well, we don't see it there, but the big thing is he kind of cross-handed as he caught the ball. There is Cumbie trailing, and he's got to be a frustrated linebacker for the Green Bay Packers.
Well, you wouldn't expect that they would be running Perry out on a pass pattern, but this young man has shown that he can do everything there is, and he's going to work on the kickoff team now to get a little more exercise.
And you got to give Mike Ditka some credit for creativity. I don't know, are the Packers going to feel less rubbing it in? I don't know. They're going to get even madder, as Forrest Gregg has got to be frustrated with a play like that. They were fooled.
They line him up on the wing, and no doubt expecting that the Packers were going to load up to try and prevent him from blocking or carrying the ball, so the Bears threw it to him. 65-yard drive, 5:17 used up on the clock. And the Bears, who had really done nothing offensively, now have the 7-3 lead. Butler will kick it off, and it's a good one. It's taken by Gary Ellis at the 3-yard line of Green Bay. Ellis picks his way out and gets over the 25 to the 26-yard line, where he's stopped by Jim Morrissey and Ron Rivera. So with 19 seconds left, Jim Zorn will bring out the Packers. And they led until these final seconds with the field goal by Al Del Greco way back on the first offensive series of Green Bay. That followed a Walter Payton fumble on the Bears' first series.
Well, I guess William Perry has to be the first two-way player since Roy Green, I guess.
I like what Ray Sons of the Chicago Sun-Times said about him last week. He called it the highest calling for a refrigerator since the first ice cube. It is first down from the 25-yard line for the Pack. Eddie Lee Ivory gets about 3 or 4 yards, and the crowd boos the running effort. And that'll be the final play of this first half. And so the teams will go to the locker rooms after a long first half of play. And now a Chicago Bear lead, 7-3. The Green Bay defense, fired up, has done the job stopping the Bear pass attack. Second down. Zorn gets it off to Ivory. He's got some room. He has a first down and gets inside Bear territory with a great second effort. All the way to the 45-yard line. Jim Zorn, way to go. 19-yard gain on the play.
That time Zorn got the protection. Watch number 50. That's Singletary. He has to take that back out of the backfield. 50 is heading towards the left side of the screen as they cleared the zone. It's a tough job for a linebacker. Everybody else was dragged down the field. And then it was Ivory against Singletary, and Ivory got a few extra yards out of it. First down again for the Green Bay Packers as Perry was also in on that tackle.
Bailey Ivory.
12 catches coming into the game. Always dangerous, runner or receiver. Carl Swanky is back in at left tackle for the Pack, number 67. And straight ahead, Ivory, this time it's stacked up. After a gain of maybe a yard, Richard Dent led the charge, number 95. And about everybody else on the Bears' front got in on it. And at the moment, they've got Hampton, McMichael, Perry, and Dent as the front four. Second and nine for the Pack.
That Chicago Bear defense allowed only 7 points in the second half in the last 5 games. That's a pretty good statistic.
The Packers in Bear territory at the 44-yard line. Zorn runs out of time, eludes the rush, the pass complete to Paul Kaufman. And Kaufman has a first down. Singletary made the tackle. First down, Green Bay at the 35. Ivory almost out of traffic. He got away from Perry, but then was met by the linebackers, Marshall and Singletary, and dropped for a loss on the play.
Now let's take a look at the what you call the intrusion by the Chicago Bears. Watch Perry and Dent, 72 and 95. They come across and get across there in front of a Moran, 57 there, and jam up the play so that nothing could go the way the Packers had designed it. So they had penetration, and that was a key to that defensive play. The Packer offensive line is having some trouble with that Bear defense on running situations.
Second and 14. Zorn starts the roll, and he is set. The flag is down away from the ball. Hampton was there. The charge led by Dent and Perry. And Hampton getting Zorn, but the flag down way over on the other side of the field.
It's going to be against Green Bay, some illegal motion. Boy, was Dent across the line of scrimmage that time.
Illegal motion, number 85, offense. Penalty is declined, third down.
Phillip Epps leaving too soon on the play.
Richard Dent, 95, was across the line of scrimmage on big Greg Cook, so quickly to the outside and just got a hand right on there. And boy, that pass rush came like it wasn't even there was nothing in the way.
Second sack of the afternoon. Dan Hampton got it, and it is a long third down.
But it was Richard Dent who came to the outside and got there first.
At the Bears' 48-yard line. Slot formation left for the Pack. Short drop by Zorn. He's got his man Lofton, and Lofton short of the first down by considerable yardage, driven out by Leslie Frazier, but they got back about 10, maybe, well, let's call it a 9-yard gain. It'll leave fourth down, however.
It looks like maybe Perry was a little shaken up on the play.
There'll be a whole lot of shaking going on, I would
yes,
say.
Yes, I would say so. There is he got dumped there a little bit. Pretty good block by Cannon, the center. He went underneath the refrigerator, then grabbed a hold of his knee. I tell you, there's some action going on
there
in the pits,
sure
isn't
is.
There?
Perry gave Cannon a knee, it appears, and Cannon then tackled him. Got to survive out there. Brokop on fourth down. A flag is down. The ball lands at the 5. And the Packers try to knock it out of bounds, and it may have been stopped, yes, just outside the goal line. 38-yarder by Prokop, but a flag down back at the line of scrimmage. And that may mean a Packer left a little too early. Great effort by the Pack down at the goal line, but illegal procedure. Somebody down a little early from the Packer front line. So Prokop delivered the perfect punt. The punt coverage team did the job, and it comes
number
back.
Number 71. Kicking team illegally downfield. Illegal formation also on the kicking team. Both fouls declined. Touchback.
See, the ball actually got to the end zone, and they're giving him a first down at the 20. So the Bears are going to refuse the penalty and take the ball.
Tim Ryan and Johnny Morris back at Soldier Field, where the Bears cling to a 7-3 lead that they earned in the final seconds of the first half. And they have the football. There was a touchback. As you see, Chicago on the season on first down, 6.1 average. Today, 2.5. As McMahon has just had trouble passing often, but not being able to hit on first down. They've got one here from the 20-yard line. Packers failed to keep the, they kept the ball out, but they got a body in the end zone on that touchback play. This is Peyton. Peyton digs for about 4 yards, gets out to the 24-yard line. That'll leave a second and six. And Ezra Johnson, number 90, the veteran from Morris Brown, made the tackle. 114 yards on the day for Peyton. He's carried the ball 18 times. And we're just into the midway part of the second period, 8:35 remaining the third period, 8:35 remaining third quarter.
You know, the Bears lead the league in scoring with 239 points, and the Packers have held them to seven through the first half, so the defense is doing something right.
Well, I think it's remarkable with those two rookie safeties in there. The man goes off to Peyton. Peyton can't get to the first down yardage. He's driven out by Tim Lewis, number 26. When you think that the Packers started Mossy Cade and Ken Stills, two rookies at safeties because of injuries, and then lose Mark Lee early in the game from the corner. It really is remarkable. They've been playing a lot of zone back there, Johnny, it appears, but it's been effective in keeping the Bears from any kind of a real pass attack.
That's right. The yards have been on the ground. And that time, Lewis came up with a good play. He had Walter Payton out in the flat one-on-one, and Walter's got that straight arm, and Lewis did a good job of knocking him out of bounds. So we have a key play, third down and about four.
Bears go to the shotgun.
Blitz.
The man with time trying to get McKinnon, and it is incomplete. Excellent coverage by Gary Hayes. He tipped the ball. McKinnon nearly made an outstanding catch. But the ball hit the ground, and Gary Hayes does the job in Mark Lee's spot.
Good coverage by Gary Hayes as McMahon kind of went out of the pocket and just threw it up here. And watch Hayes recover here. The pass is up and over, and McKinnon almost made a super catch as he was falling down. But Hayes gets up there, bats the ball. Now watch him. He's falling on his back, and he almost hangs on to the ball. And it hits right there before he can catch the ball. That was almost a circus catch, but give Hayes some credit. He was right there on Dennis McKinnon.
So the Bears will have to punt as the Pack defense shuts him down again. Buford standing at his 12-yard line. The deep man is Phillip Epps at the Pack of 35. Larry Buford, first in the NFC in punting.
He grabbed him again.
And he gets a dandy here. On the 31-yard line, Epps with another flag down on the play. A penalty flag down as Epps got to the 36-yard line. 43-yarder. Dennis Gentry made the tackle. Let's see what this one is. This has been a flag-filled game, to say the least. The holding call is signaled against Green Bay. We are told that Willie Gault has suffered a rib injury and will not return to this football game. We don't know
holding
the extent of that injury.
Number 24, receiving team, after the kick, post possession. First down.
Second and one. Ivory has the first down. Out to the 34-yard line where Singletary made the tackle. The Packers have sent in Tim Huffman to replace Rich Moran at left guard. Huffman just activated this week off injured reserve. 6'5", 280-pounder out of Notre Dame. Moran went off with a little bit of a nick of some kind. Moran was starting for the injured Keith Uecker.
Ed West has come in, so they're going to go into a two tight end situation now. He's 86.
Ball at the 34-yard line of the Pack. One setback is Clark. They give it to Clark. Ran into his own blocker. And Clark. What a piece of running by Jesse Clark. Turned that into about a 9-yard gain after William Perry had pushed his blocker into his path. Singletary and Frazier made the tackle.
Let's watch the outside. Watch the right of your screen as you'll see Otis Wilson and Marshall come across. You can see 72 Perry, but there's the push out, and then Clark does a good job of turning in and making yards on his own out of that. He really did. Good job by Clark. One of 13 children.
Son of a sharecropper in Arkansas, went to the University of Arkansas. He is quite a story, quite a young man. That is Clark for the first down, and he's got it to the 45-yard line where McMichael made the tackle. So
the Packers get something moving as we see Pittsburgh leading Cleveland 7-6 in the third quarter. Minnesota ahead of Detroit 13-10. And this one's still knotted up. Tampa Bay and New York and the Dolphins, who have been struggling, having a time with the Patriots 10-3 in the AFC East action.
Bears are in their 46th defense now.
Goes down at the 45-yard line. Wide open in the middle, Jesse Clark.
Were in their 46th defense, and it was only for Clark to get outside that blitz. You see, Wilbur Marshall was in on the blitz. He caught the ball. Zorn picked it up, and it was Gary Fensick, 45, the only man with the chance to catch him. And Jesse Clark had a little speed, gave him a little straight arm, hit him right in the chin with the straight arm, pushed him off, and went into the end zone. Great play for the Green Bay Packers. They beat the Bears, where they're sometimes vulnerable on that all-out blitz.
Del Greco to the point after Zorn to hold. Packers are back in front. 79 yards in five plays. The big one to this man. And it is 10-7.
Use double miles from their Capital One Venture card to fly home for the big family reunion.
You must be Garth's father.
Hello. Mother.
Lover. Traveling is easy with the Venture card because you can fly any airline, anytime.
Two words.
Double miles!
This guy can act.
Want to play Dodge Rock?
Up you guys. And with double miles you can actually use, you never miss the fun.
Beard growing contest and go!
I win!
What's in your wallet?
I'm Reed Timmer, and I rely on Bosch wipers in extreme weather. You should, too. Let's prove it by putting your blades to the test.
What was that?
Minivan.
Oh, oh.
Let's try it again with these. Get exclusive Bosch beam technology for superior all-weather performance. Bosch, clear the way.
Pizza Hut is changing the way we eat pizza forever.
With new big pizza sliders. 9 in a box for just $10.
What?
I like that, man.
Only at your Pizza Hut.
Now that's how you make it great.
So this performance basketball is another way Bridgestone is bringing its tire technologies to the world of sports.
You got it. The same Serenity technology that absorbs road noise with our Turanza tires is being tested here with the help of Tim Duncan and Steve Nash.
So how exactly would this revolutionize the game?
It's quiet.
What's that?
That's our sleeping baby test. At Bridgestone, our passion for performance knows no bounds.
He's a football phenomenon.
When you don't fit the mold, it messes with their heads.
Now hear the story.
I promise you, he is a winner.
From the five quarterbacks who paved the way.
Just kept getting stronger for Tebow. The team believed in him.
There's only one person that carries the ball right here.
Give him a touchdown.
What he brings to the table is the heart of a lion, and he wins.
The Faces of Tebow, A Football Life, Wednesday at 9, exclusively on NFL Network.
Tim Ryan with Johnny Morris at Lambeau Field. Jesse Clark has just scored the longest touchdown pass of the season for the Green Bay Packers, 55 yards, and they're back in front by three. Al Del Greco, the Bears without the league's leading kickoff returner, Willie Gauley's on the sidelines. It is Taylor from the 10 to the 28 of the Chicago Bears. Packers say they have the football. No signal from the officials, however. And again, the Pack fired up as they've regained the lead. Will be Chicago ball. John Dorsey, the man who grabbed it,
Okay, now you're going to see Jesse Clark right here. He's going to get through here. Number 50, Mike Singletary, is going to blitz, and so is number 58. He's way out to the left, but you watch number 58. He runs right by Clark and doesn't try and jam him. 58, Wilbur Marshall. And you'll see it come right down to the left of your screen. Right there as 58 went by on the blitz, and Clark opened up over the middle. And defensive coordinators tell your blitzers, knock a back out and don't let him get out.
First down, Chicago. McMahon sideliner. It is complete to McKinnon. McKinnon picks up about 7 yards on the play. John Anderson made the tackle. Mossy Cade in on it as well. It'll be second and 3. That's the first time today that McMahon has been able to hit a first down pass, and that's been a big weapon in the Bears offense through the first 8 unbeaten games. Second and 3. From their own 35-yard line. Bears trailed 3-0 on the first series of the game after they had popped up the ball, the first Packer offensive series. Went ahead in the final seconds of the first half. Walter Payton has a first down at the 40-yard line. Brian Noble, the Arizona State rookie, made the stop.
The old Schustein tackle by Noble, who is getting his fill of Walter Payton. They seem to be running by one another, but Noble is a young man who's played very well, is going to be one of the great linebackers in this National Football League. He has done a heck of a job, and he's a big linebacker.
Oh, is he huge. Yeah, he awesome is. To see him stand down beside him on the practice field.
His arms are bigger than our legs.
119 yards on the day for Walter Payton. Bears in the I formation. Payton driven back this time. The pack surging to the football holds him to little of any gain. Randy Scott, the defensive captain, led the charge.
And here is the version of the Packer 46. Number 24, a little old Mossy Cade, has got to stay in there. The Bears spotted this 46, and they tried to run at him. And watch him jam it up. He has to take on big defensive linemen. Right here as they come, Mark Bortz, 62. 24, Mossy Cade just hangs right in there and makes the play. Great play.
It is second and 10 from the 40-yard line. Man deep for Marjoram. Incomplete. Gary Hayes on the coverage. A pass a little bit underthrown, although it might have been farther than Marjoram thought. But Hayes was there at the critical time when the ball came down.
So far, Gary Hayes has an A today. As the ball comes down, he's right with Marjoram step for step. Marjoram stops. I think you're right. He might have misjudged just a little bit. And then Hayes goes up and bats it away. Good play. McMahon had all day to throw that ball as he went on a rollout. He had a personal bodyguard in Mark Bortz, and the Packers had to cover a long time, and Hayes did the job.
Gary Hayes, as we commented, came in to replace Mark Lee, who was thrown out of the football game for knocking Walter Payton to the bench back early in the first period. Ronnie Burgess and Tom Flinter in the secondary on third down. Character for the pass rush. McMahon under pressure. Gets it off. Complete to Payton. Payton dancing up the sideline. And Oxley inbounds. He's out of bounds at the 45. McMahon paid the price with two defenders chasing him. It is fourth down.
The frustrated Jim McMahon. You saw the shot at him as the Packers put the blitz on, a safety blitz, and McMahon is so agile, but credit John Anderson, 59, for continuing the pressure, and he was able to get the pass off, but Payton was not able to get the first down, and the Packers have held the Chicago Bears and will get the ball back.
Tough defense by the Pack. Remarkable story today with two rookies in the secondary. Phillip Epps is the deep man. Buford will punt, standing at his 30-yard line. Shifting around on this punt play.
Trying to draw him off sides because it's third and about 4.5.
Buford's punt taken by Epps with a fair catch at the 21. And the Pack will start from there. They lead 10-7 with 2:36 remaining in the third quarter. The crowd getting into the
fired up action of their team. With 2:36 to play in the third period, the Packers have had the ball for 8 minutes and 44 seconds here in the second half and rolled up 121 yards in the touchdown. They have the ball now following the Bear punt at their own 20-yard line. Mike Hartenstein has come in defensively. William Perry is out on this first down play. Jesse Clark, the lone setback. Double tight end, long count by Zorn. Clark. He is met at the line of scrimmage by Singletary, the linebacker, and held to about a yard on the play. It'll leave second and 9. So Jim Zorn came up with a big play, hitting the wide open Jesse Clark. Talking with Zorn yesterday, asking about his preparation for this week once he was told he'd have the start. He said, well, my wife, Joy, helped me out a lot at home with a playbook. She'd give me a little quiz and see if I could come up with the right numbers and terminology. So he's giving her some credit for his pregame preparation. And his daughter Rachel, who's 5 years old, asking him, is he going to play this week? He was glad to hear he was. Second and 9. It is almost intercepted by Wilson, intended for Phillip Epps. Now, had the ball been higher, Epps was open past Wilson. A flag is down again. So two near misses. Had the ball been higher, it could have been a big gainer for the Pack. It nearly turned into an interception for Chicago.
The penalty is going against Green Bay once again.
Holding. Number 86. Offense. Still second down.
That is Ed West, the second tight end on second tight end in on the play. The second year man from Auburn charged with the holding.
There's total offense by half, 153 to 68 in the first half, and look at how the turnaround has come about. 127 to 24 in favor of Green Bay in the second half. They did start to run a little more successfully early in the second half.
That's the 8th penalty taken by the Packers, the 13th on the game. It's cost the Pack 66 yards. And they're now second and 20 from the 12. Layers it out to Jesse Clark by himself. He's met by Duerson and dropped there at about the 14-yard line. Richard Dent came over to help out Duerson. And it'll be a 2-yard pickup.
There is
third and 18.
Excuse me, Tim. There's the concentration by Jim Zorn as he looks to the sideline for the play. So they have opted to do mostly from the sidelines. Once in a while, they bring a play in. So. He said if he had to choose a team that he would go in against his first start, the last team he would pick would be the Chicago Bears. I don't blame him as far as that with their defensive record.
Well, he was excited about the challenge, as he called it, but obviously that defense that the Bears threw at you would have been a little more pleasant debut against someone else. Third down. And it's complete to Epps. And Zorn finding the targets here in the second half. Brokop hits this one to the 30-yard line of the Bears. Duerson dancing his way over the 40, got to about the 41-yard line. Ed West made the tackle there. Good field position for the Chicago Bears, who trail by 3. Next Sunday, the Bears will be at home against the Detroit Lions. And the Lions are now tied up with Minnesota, our last report, at 13-all in the fourth quarter. The Rams and the Giants, Green Bay at Minnesota, St. Louis at Tampa Bay begins our doubleheader action at 12:30 Eastern time, and then the Dallas Cowboys and the Washington Redskins. The Redskins were beating up on Atlanta the last scores we had. Dallas plays tomorrow night. First down. Draw play, Payton. Payton still going. Has a first down to the 45-yard line of Green Bay. Ken Stills and Mossy Cade, the safeties, put the stop on him there. And now Payton has reached 133 yards on 21 carries. Time winding down in the third quarter.
Houston leads Kansas City in the fourth quarter. And look what Washington, 34-3 over Atlanta. Buffalo losing to Cincinnati 20-10 in the fourth quarter. And 5 seconds left in the quarter here.
Four wide receivers for this final play. And they're not going to get it off. So we come to the end of the third quarter with the score. The Green Bay Packers 10. Sky is a little bit darker as we see that the Bears, first game that they haven't led this season after the third quarter. They trail 10-7. But they have the football at the Packer 45-yard line. McMahon deep for Marjoram. Incomplete. Again, tight coverage, this time by Tim Lewis. McMahon had the ball right there. It would have been a circus catch for Marjoram, so the credit goes to Lewis, who broke it up.
Yes, Tim Lewis, who had 7 interceptions last year but hasn't gotten any this year, stayed with Marjoram and just timed his leap and knocked the ball away at the last second. He just did a good job on the coverage. Marjoram almost hung onto that ball. Down it goes as the Packers have responded to the Bears' passing charge.
Tim Lewis.
He wanted to know whether this game was going back to Philadelphia. He said, my folks are watching. I told him, no, not Philadelphia.
Well, about 40% of the country watching this one. The unbeaten Chicago Bears, the story of the league this year. McMahon runs out of time and a sack. Randy Scott, number 55, drops him at the 40-yard line. Meanwhile, Robert Brown and Keith Van Horn get at it. And then Jay Hilgenberg comes over to toss off a Packer and act as a peacemaker. That's hard to do at the same time. The Pack continues to stay mad and fired up.
Jim McMahon couldn't spot Matt Sui coming down over the middle. He was open, and the pass rush just kept coming and kept coming. And finally, it was Randy Scott getting past Thayer there and getting through. Okay, here's the main combatants, Keith Van Horn and Robert Brown, as he hit Van Horn. And then Van Horn gets up, and he throws Robert Brown to the ground right here. And down goes 93, so that wound up a draw, I guess. Things are getting a little bit ugly.
Humphrey was trying to cool the tempers down. Glenn and Burgess are in the secondary, third and very long from the Bears' 40-yard line. Third and 25. A draw play to Peyton. Peyton picks up about 10 of that. It's over midfield, but will leave fourth down for Chicago. And the punting unit comes on. Anderson and Stills. And listen to this crowd salute the defense. Two numbers stick out. The Packers had the ball for 10 minutes and 35 seconds in the third quarter. And they have prevented the Bears from doing anything. Jim Zorn, meanwhile, offensively, who went 2-for-10 in the first half, is 6-for-6 in the second half. A high punt by Buford. Fair catch signaled at the 5-yard line by Philip Epps. Well, you might question that. A 45-yard punt. And the Packers will start from inside their 5 when we return. Forrest Gregg had been complaining openly about some of the mistakes in judgment made by his punt returners. Philip Epps elected on this one to fair catch the ball inside the 5-yard line.
Well, there's an unwritten rule. You don't fair catch behind the 10-yard line. Sometimes there are mitigating circumstances, but you know, you got to take your chances when it hits at the 4 that it's going to go into the end zone, I think.
So Jim Zorn, 6-for-6 in the second half. And his first start as a Packer will try and get them out from near their end zone. Ivory in motion. Jesse Clark stacked up at the 5-yard line. Got a yard maybe. So we're glad to see Jesse Clark up on his feet. Chatting with Forrest Gregg, and I'm sure we'll see him back. It is 2nd and 9 from the 5-yard line. Pitch out to Ivory. Ivory cutting back inside, nowhere to go. He's met by Hartenstein. And Hartenstein holds him to about a 1-yard, maybe 2-yard gain. Clark comes right back in for the Pack. Mike Hartenstein lost his starting job for the first time today to William Perry, but getting his action.
The key here was Mike Singletary. You'll see a number 50 coming through, and he beats the block by Ron Hallstrom. This is not him, but he comes right across there. Watch 50 come into the picture and beat the block by number 65 to the outside 50 right there, getting buried, but he forced the run back in.
So this third down into the end zone goes Zorn, and he is dropped by McMichael. A safety by the Bears on a third down pass play. Their second safety in as many weeks.
So a big play for the Chicago Bears as Jim Zorn had no chance to get rid of the ball. McMichael was there before you could turn around and say anything as he just made a nice little head slap and comes from the right of your screen and puts the sack on Jim Zorn. The Bears now have a 1-point deficit. The Packers still lead 10-9, but that changes the situation for the Chicago Bears as Steve McMichael comes through with a big play.
12:18 remaining regulation time. The Packers. Joe Prokop will punt the ball following the safety, and it is a short punt. It is picked up now by Dennis McKinnon, and McKinnon will get to midfield before he is stopped. So the Bears will start with excellent field position. And again, the Bluebirds out on Joe Prokop's case here, as that 16-yard return has got the Bears at midfield.
Prokop has had his problems, as we've mentioned. The Packers had three or four punters in this week to take a look at them, but they have not activated a new punter, but there's no question he's having his problems.
So Chicago, trailing by a point, has the ball at the 50-yard line. Slot formation right. First time today they've had the possession in Green Bay territory. And Walter Payton turns out about 6 yards, moving it to the 44-yard line where Tim Lewis made the tackle. We have 11:58 remaining in regulation time. The safety by McMichael following one scored by the Bears a week ago.
Okay, the man to watch here is the guard, Mark Bortz. He will pull out, and Mossy Cade, little Mossy Cade, is going to take a real big hit right up there. You take a look at it now. Watch number 62 all the way, and you'll see what those linemen, they have to play in the pit, and then they got to pull out, and here comes the block that springs Payton. 62 on Cade. Payton turns in.
Second down and 4 to go. Chicago. Quick pass. The tight end Whiteman is open. First down to the 28-yard line. And McMahon took a lick from Douglas after he released the ball, but it's a 17-yard gain.
Key play by, you're going to see 53 blitz. There goes 53, and Reitman just comes out, finds a clear opening. McMahon spotted him, and Reitman goes straight down the field. Big gain for the Chicago Bears. They picked up the blitz and beat the blitz. You give the receiver credit also.
Tim Reitman's second catch today. Ken Stills made the tackle. First down. Bears in Packer territory. Chicago has come from behind in 5 out of their 8 victories. A trailing score here by a point. Payton bounces off Packers. Touchdown. Walter Payton has been most of the Bears' offense today. And fittingly, for the Chicago Bears, he scores that touchdown that puts them ahead.
Okay, great running, good blocking as Matt Sui goes in for the key block, and then the turnaround as he turns upside, got the block by Keith Van Horn on Robert Brown, and then you dip Payton to the outside. Did you see him run by Hayes there, 27? He still has that speed, and I don't care how old he is, pushing 31, that's not old. But they say it's old for a running back, but not for Walter Payton, as Mike Ditka says, thank you, Walter, you made me look good again.
27 yards for the score, 175 yards on 24 carries. Butler with a point after. It is good. So the Bears turned that short punt following the safety into a touchdown, 49 yards in 3 plays. That is Gary Ellis for the Pack. Drove through one tackler with a good effort, got out to the 21-yard line of Green Bay. 10:21 remains in regulation time. A 6-point Bear margin. Jim Morrissey made the tackle. And Reggie Phillips.
You know, it's almost a crime to have a guy like James Lofton play a football game and just not be any factor at all. Let's see if they try and take a look at Jim Zorn today. First half and second half, big difference.
First down. Zorn brings him out. He's been flawless passing in the second half, but his team is trailing. Good shot for Reddy Lee Ivory. Ivory gets 5, maybe 4 yards, we'll call it, out to the 24-yard line. Wilbur Marshall and Otis Wilson, the linebackers, 58 and 55 on the tackle.
It's good to see that Jesse Clark is back and apparently not too serious an injury.
And we see Ivory coming off limping some after taking that hit. It'll leave 2nd and 6 at the 25-yard line. Ed West comes in, 2 tight ends in the lineup, the lone setback, Jesse Clark.
177!
Clark gets a good block. And a good recovery by Wilbur Marshall as Clark nearly burst loose. Had a lot of daylight ahead of him, and Marshall hauled him down. It'll be close to the first down.
It's going to be about 3rd and 1. Now, the Packers don't have a refrigerator. They don't have an ice box. They do have an elevator, but I don't think they're going to use Donnie Humphrey.
Yes, it's just short of the first down. In fact, they had Donnie Humphrey carrying the ball on one play in practice as well. So it is Clark and Ellis now in the backfield on this short yardage situation. It's literally inches to go at the 31-yard line. Jim Zorn, who hadn't started a game since 1983, lost his job in Seattle to Dave Craig, said he was certainly sympathetic to Lynn Dickey. Said, it's happened to me. I know what he's going through this week. And I'm excited about playing the Bears.
Well, it looks like they're going to run out of the eye. Nope.
Ellis in motion. Clark stacked up and maybe short. And a little extracurricular activity again. West and one of the Bears players. Otis Wilson, I believe.
I don't see any flags down, do you?
No, I don't. They've really let a lot of that stuff go, which I think is okay if it doesn't get out of
apparently
hand.
Apparently was some kind of a call, but I didn't see a flag fall.
Well, evidently there is a flag down in that pile. Now I see the flag in the midst of all the feet.
It must have been post-play action.
Well, maybe that came from
the altercation.
Yeah. But meanwhile, it looked to me like the Packers didn't quite make the yardage.
No, they did not.
Personal foul. Defense. The foul was after the play. The foul was after the play. It will be first and it'll be first and 10 for the defense after a 15-yard penalty.
Okay, well, all right, what's happened here is that they did stop them short, evidently, although they didn't say that.
15-yard penalty, first down for the offense.
Yeah, he said defense. It confused us a little bit here. Because it couldn't be first down for the defense because it would have been 4th down. So it's a first down. Basically what we have is a first down play, a post-play foul.
Right. It would have been 4th down. The penalty against the Bears gives them 1st down. At the 45-yard line of Green Bay. High formation.
Blitz.
Deep for Lofton, wide open, but overthrown. Zorn had Lofton wide open, and another flag is down. Well, Ken Taylor got a sample of Lofton's moves and speed on that play in the Bears secondary. But Zorn couldn't get him the ball.
Number 21 defense, 5 yards, automatic first down.
Defensive holding against Les Frazier. And Singletary on the field for the Bears is just furious. They're trying to get his team to keep their heads together defensively here.
Let's see the infractions. That's Epps that he's covering against. He grabs him and holds him. I would say that's a good call. I would say it's a correct call.
So it is 1st down at midfield. In motion, Ellis. Short drop and
almost intercepted, then almost completed. It was Singletary with a hand on the ball. Paul Kaufman, the tight end number 82, nearly picked it off the deflection.
And originally Kaufman was open. Zorn just kind of missed through a little bit, and then Singletary, as you said, almost had it, and then Kaufman almost had it. So we got a final score, our first final score, Minnesota over Detroit, 16-13. That's a blow to the Lions, who play the Bears next week. The Lions are now 5-4.
And Minnesota is 5-4. That's the first incompletion by Zorn in this second half, and we have 8:34 to play in the fourth quarter. Second and 10, they go to Clark, and Clark gets only a yard, if that, as the Bears defensive line now starting to outmuscle the Packers offensive unit, Hampton and McMichael on the tackle.
Well, it appears that the Packers continue to say that we can run against the Bear defense, and if you take their average per carry, they definitely are not moving the ball on the ground on first or second down. I mean, they've got to run here or run there, but by and large, they've been stopped.
Well, now it is third down and about 9.5. Still at the midfield stripe. 16-10 Bears. Big play for the Green Bay Packers. Short drop. Sideliner for Lofton and overthrown. Green Bay will have to punt. So the clock now becomes a big factor. 7:47 remains in regulation time. Chicago will have the football, and they hold a six-point margin.
Well, they finally went to James Lofton, and sure enough, there were two Chicago Bears there, double covering him.
Rokop at his 36-yard line. Dave Duerson standing at the Bear 10-yard line. Duerson on the run at the 15. Out to the 23-yard line of Chicago. And Lynn Dickey is warming up on the sideline for the Packers. We'll watch that development. There's Walter Payton, and he slipped at the 30-yard line trying to make a cut after he had gained about 7. It'll leave a 2nd and 3. Hayes and Humphrey made the tackle, and Lynn Dickey, who said yesterday, I guess I'll think about myself having a niche as a reliever. And I asked Lynn directly, I said, Lynn, might you have started your last game as a Green Bay Packer last week? And he said, after a moment's pause and thought, maybe I have. But retirement, he's going to wait till the end of the year to decide about that. 2nd and 3. Forrest Gregg says that he hasn't committed himself to Zorn or any other quarterback as a starter for the rest of the season. That was going to depend on Zorn's performance today. Payton trying to drive for the first down, but a stack of Green Bay shirts will hold him short by at least a yard. It'll be 3rd, and depending on the spot, it looks like it'll be just about a yard to go on 3rd down.
As he helps Donnie Humphrey up off the turf, and you said a whole bunch of Green Bay Packers, and there were. You have to gang tackle him with 4 or 5 guys because he still slips forward. He ended up almost getting the first down just because of determination. He keeps those legs moving even on his way down.
Donnie Humphrey and Mossy Cade on the tackle. Bears are only 1 of 8 on 3rd downs today. They need a little less than a yard here. Walter Payton, and he has it to the 35-yard line. 6 minutes and counting down. So the Bears have possession. No doubt we'll be just trying to work on that clock with their 6-point margin. Johnson and Brown made the stop.
And there you can see the signaling in. Steve Fuller was signaling in to McMahon. And of course he takes the calls from Mike Ditka. And that's Ed Hughes in the center, the offensive coordinator. As the Bears obviously are going to try and eat this clock up. 5:34. It is running.
McMahon calls a timeout. As the Pack may have given him a little defensive look, he wanted to make sure that he has the right play for that look. And he'll take the timeout. Payton Picks up another five over the 40-yard line.
You know, if I was Green Bay now, the way the Bears are running the ball, playing fairly normal defenses, if I was the Packers, I'd have to take my chances that the Bears aren't going to throw, or at least the odds are that they aren't going to throw, and I'd have to start blitzing, filling all the gaps, and worry about stopping Peyton, because if they don't do that, they're not going to win anyway.
192 yards today, 28 carries by Walter Peyton. So when your pass offense is not up to par, or the defense is doing the job on it, give it to Peyton. Second and five. This is Sui's turn. He gets about three. It'll leave third and two for Chicago. They're now out at their 43-yard line. Brian Noble and Randy Scott, the inside linebackers in the 3-4, made the tackle for the Pack.
And this could be the key play of the football game right here. Third and two. 4 minutes, 24 seconds.
If the Packers can get the ball back with any decent field position, with a six-point margin, they would have ample time to score the winning points. Third down. Reichman off the winning motion. Sui behind Peyton. He is stopped. Excellent defensive play. Mike Douglas, number 53.
Well, the Bears tried to cross up. They used Peyton as a blocker and Matt Sui as a runner. Matt Sui is a good ball player, but when you got the key, there's 53, Mike, off of 80. Reitman is the blocker, 53, Michael Douglas plays off that and makes the tackle on Matt Sui. But I'd have to give it to my super pro, Walter Peyton, on a third and two with 4 minutes to go.
Well, whatever the game film showed about Douglas last week, they're going to show him grading out real well here today, win or lose. Douglas, Mossy Cade, and most of the Green Bay defense has played awfully well. So the Bears will have to punt the Packers now with 3-9 and ticking. The Bears, using up as much as they can, are still going to have ample time to make something happen. Buford hits from the 34. Phillip Epps at the 14. He's got some running room. Bears overran the coverage, and he got over the 25 to the 27, where Sean Gale made the stop. Hang on to your hats, folks. 2:54. First down, Green Bay, at their 26-yard line. Dickey talking to Forrest Gregg on the sideline, but Zorn on the field.
I wouldn't think you would go to Lynn Dickey, but you're in the situation. Zorn has done much better in the second half. And
yes, he has. Kaufman and West, the double tight ends. If you get to a two-minute drill, you might be tempted to use Lynn Dickey, just on experience. Reverse to James Lofton. He runs around Duerson, who makes a tackle from behind. Well, Duerson was prepared for that play, but Lofton still picked up about four by getting wide on Duerson, and I guess you credit Duerson for not letting him get up the field.
Well, at least James Lofton got his hands on the ball.
Yes, he did. He'd been running downfield all day trying to get one via the aerial route. Winds up taking a half handoff as a reverse.
Well, the Packers continue to run on first down. Although that was different.
Clark and Ivory are the running backs. Second and seven. Play action. Diving try by Epps, incomplete. Just off his fingertips. Zorn really had something on that ball, and Epps had to dive because he couldn't catch up to it with a stride.
Boy, you're really right. He put the mustard on that ball, and Epps came through and almost made a fantastic grab. It was a super effort. Couldn't quite hang on to the ball, so it's going to be a third down and about seven for Green Bay.
Well, effectively, they've got two downs here to keep the ball. If they can keep the ball, they've got a chance to get into the Bears' end zone. Zorn is 0-3 in the fourth period after going 6-for-6 in the third. He hits this one to Clark. He's hit by Otis Wilson, short of the first down. He gets to the 35-yard line. They'll need a little more than a yard. Wilson joined by Wilbur Marshall on the stop.
Well, I think they have to go for it. 2:21 left in the game as Jim Zorn looks for the call, and Mike Ditka says that's not a good call.
What's your call, Johnny?
I think they have to throw. I just don't, with the Bears, they either have to go try and go around end or throw the ball, but trying to run up the middle against the Bear defense, I think it's going to be a little shaky.
All right, the two-minute warning has sounded. Bears in front by six. Tim Ryan with Johnny Morris at Lambeau Field. And when you've got Jim Zorn, Johnny, I think on fourth and two, you've got to have a rollout play so that he can run if he doesn't have a man open. What's your call?
Well, I think, I don't know how much they've hooked on the rollout, but that's a good call because Zorn is a good runner, or there's some kind of a short pass that's got to be quick.
Well, this is the game here for the Packers. If they can keep the ball, they've got a shot. Rolling, but he's deep, and it is complete for Eddie Lee Ivory. First down, Green Bay. In traffic, Zorn threaded the needle into Ivory. Frazier was there for the Bears. Singletary was there. What a job by Zorn.
Well, he rolled out and forced Greg called the wide play to give him some kind of an option. Now Ivory almost was surprised to get the ball. Watch Singletary and Taylor. Everybody's right there. And they can't believe that ball got through as Ivory made a great grab.
You know, Frazier might even add a hand on it. Looked like on the replay. Great job, Zorn and Ivory. Sideliner for Kaufman. He's got it. First down, Green Bay. Paul Kaufman. He's been a big play man for a long time in his eighth year.
Here's an isolation with Otis Wilson, 55, the linebacker, off the 46 defense, has to go with Kaufman all the way. Kaufman dips to the outside. The pass was thrown right over perfectly to Kaufman. There was nothing that Otis Wilson could do about the play.
Kaufman told us yesterday he had to get away from Wilson and from Wilbur Marshall in that situation. He expected that kind of bumping at the line of scrimmage, and he met the challenge there.
He certainly did, and he's one of the guys that has a bone to pick with the Bears, too. He's very upset about what he feels were some cheap shots back in the game in Chicago. But everybody has hard feelings, and I guess it's always that way between the Packers and Bears, but maybe this game a little bit more than I can ever remember.
They each have two timeouts remaining with 1:16 on the clock. Kaufman's third catch of the game, the key one here, as the Packers now at the Bears 45. Now they trail by six. So they've got to have the touchdown and the point after. There's Buddy Ryan with Mike Ditka talking defense. Hope they looked unhappy with something. I guess the coverage on the last play. First down. Play action. Zorn with time. Deep sideline. Lofton out of bounds. Lofton was open on the sideline but had nowhere to go. He had about a yard before he was going to step out. Taylor had the coverage. The rookie number 31.
You know, that was a situation where Zorn, being a little bit rusty, hasn't played much, he could have taken off down the sidelines that time and probably gained 15 or 20 yards because he had gotten outside the pocket. But the one thing that he has shown is the ability to move around in the pocket very well, just kind of like the knack that McMahon has had.
William Perry has come in. Hartenstein out for the Bears on second and 10. Zorn stumbled but recovered. Going for Epps. Frazier is there. It is incomplete. Epps, I think, thought Frazier had a chance at an intercept, and he made some contact with him. There was no call, however, and the ball was well overthrown. Third down.
There was no call, and there shouldn't have been any call. Epps dives for the ball and just comes across on Frazier, so that's what you call incidental contact. Boy, it was Jesse Clark open, 33, out in the flat that time. Zorn just didn't spot him. He could have run 15 yards with the ball.
Third down again for Green Bay at the Bears 45. They need 10 yards this time. 105 on the clock. Incomplete. He threw it into the ground in front of Phillip Epps. One more play for the Packers. Zorn unhappy with himself. But I just didn't get it there. He was open.
Well, I'd have to say we're down to the old ball game now. Fourth and 10.
Clark and Ellis in the backfield. Ivory comes out. 1 minute, 1 second to play. Bears that amount of time away from their ninth consecutive victory without defeat. Short drop Zorn, and it is incomplete again. Intended for Epps, but there might have been a little cross up there in communication on the route between quarterback and receiver. But it is moot. 58 seconds on the clock. Chicago Bear football. And the Bears off to their best start since 1942, trying to go one at a time as they continue to save, but thinking and talking about an undefeated season. They think it's possible.
And you got to give this man a lot of credit. He came in here with the Chicago Bears about 3 years ago, wound up with a 3-6 record. The next year they went to 8-8. Last year, 10-6 into the playoffs, one game away from the Super Bowl, and has begun this year now at 9-0. So what can you say? He has done the job for the Chicago Bears.
The Bears knew how fired up the Packers were, but they just said, well, so what? Let them be fired up. We'll be ready to play. And they'll just wind down the clock here, 55 seconds and counting. And they have shown poise and confidence. They kept their cool. A few scuffles on the field, one player or another.
And you can see they have one man way back in case there's a fumble, which is unlikely with the quarterback dropping down.
So the Packers take their final timeout with 52 seconds left, hoping for some miracle here to get the ball. Which will not change the final result. As we wind down another few seconds.
The Bears will have won 15 of their last 16 regular season NFC Central Division games. So Mike Ditka says the key to winning and getting to the playoffs is winning your division. Boy, he has really done that. Now the clock is winding down and it's going to actually be stopped. So we're going to have another play.
Well, here's good news for Tampa Bay Buccaneers fans. They won their first game today and they hurt the Giants. Brent Musburger will have the details, and Mike Ditka curious on the sideline at something. The clock is now, the Bears have called timeout. Well, oh, I'm sorry. Sorry. Let me correct the final score here. I've been reading it incorrectly. Tampa Bay scored in the final couple of minutes, but the Giants won 22-20. Thank you, producer David Michaels, for the correction. So don't get excited, Buccaneers fans. Your team is still winless.
Now we have an interesting situation here because it's a fourth down. The Bears would be forced to punt. They don't want to give the Packers a chance for a punt return, but if they ran the ball, as soon as he's down, that's this clock is stopped because it's change of possession, and the Packers would get the ball further upfield. So that's the situation they're talking about. The clock does not continue to run when it's a change of possession, assuming that the Packers stopped them from getting a first down, which you would have to assume at fourth and about 14. So now they're going to have to decide that they're going to punt. And Mike Ditka was a little bit upset that they got themselves in this situation.
Well, Buford comes on to punt now. Epps, who must be considered dangerous at any time he can get his hands on the football, is back at the 20-yard line. And it is Epps at the 20. Out of bounds as time expires at the 30-yard line, and this football game is over. The Chicago Bears have won their ninth consecutive game of the season. And Mike Ditka walks off the field with victory number 9 in his pocket. A struggle here against a fired-up Green Bay Packer team, but the Bears, on Peyton's 27-yard touchdown run in the fourth period, defeat the Packers 16-10.